Hello, I'm Robin Whalley, welcome to Lenscraft. Today, I'm returning to Affinity Photo to look more closely at blending ranges. I did cover them briefly in an earlier video, when I also looked at the blend if feature in Photoshop. What you can see at the moment is a tone strip that I've created, and it's going to help to explain blending ranges. It runs from black on the left to white on the right, and has four black and white rectangles. In Affinity Photo, the image tones have a value of between 0% and 100%. The percentage is the amount of white that appears in that tone. When you have a tone that's pure black, it has a value of 0% because there's no white. At the opposite end of the scale, white has a tonal value of 100%. In the middle of the strip, there's an equal level of black and white, so the tone is 50%. I'll now use a copy of this tone strip to demonstrate the blending range feature in Affinity Photo. If you want to try this with your own image, I'll put a copy of this strip on my website and a link to it in the video information below. Here you can see one of my landscape photos with the tone strip appearing as a second layer in the image. I'll select the tone strip layer and then click the gear icon in the Layer Studio panel. This opens the Blending Options dialog. The first thing to notice is that we have two sets of similar controls. The grid on the left controls the blending of the tone strip layer, whilst the second grid controls the layers below it. You can think of the grid as being a graph. The horizontal axis represents the tonal values of pixels in the layer. This goes from 0% or black on the left to 100% or white on the right. The vertical axis represents the opacity of the layer from 0% at the bottom to 100% opacity at the top. Currently, you can see a line running along the top of the grid with a point at either end. The left point tells us that the black pixels on the layer have an opacity of 100%. The other point on the right shows the white tones also have an opacity of 100%. In fact, the entire line runs along the top of the grid. This tells us that every tone from black through to white has an opacity of 100%, which is why we can see the entire strip. Now let's drag the black point down and set the opacity to zero. Notice how all the black tones in the layer become transparent, but you can still see the whites. Because the line runs diagonal, the opacity in the tones gradually increases as the tones get lighter. If you look at the mid-tone grey, the opacity is 50%. Let's reset the adjustments and this time move to the white point. The white tones are now transparent, but the black tones are visible. Let's add a point to the mid-tone and set its opacity to 0%. As you can see, the middle of the strip now becomes transparent, but the whites and blacks are still fully visible. What's happening is we're controlling the areas of the layer that are visible based on the tones in that layer. I also want to mention this linear option. At the moment it's selected and the line between the points is straight. Watch what happens to the line when I unselect it and keep watching the centre of the strip as well. The line now becomes curved rather than straight. This is creating a more gradual transition in the blending. I'll reset the control again and we can look at the other grid. The other grid works much like the first grid. We have the tonal range from black on the left to white on the right. The vertical axis also controls the opacity, but the results with this grid are slightly different. When I moved the black point in the other grid, it made the dark parts of the tone strip transparent. In this grid, it makes the strip partly transparent, but across the entire tone strip. The opacity of the strip is being determined by the tones in the image below it. Where you see dark tones in the underlying image, the strip becomes transparent. I'll reverse the settings now so that areas of white in the image make the strip transparent. You may be able to see it better if I move the strip around. One final point to mention is that each layer in the image has a separate set of blending range controls. When I click on the background layer, I can change its transparency or its opacity using the source layer ranges. But notice the other controls have no effect because there's nothing below the background layer to control the blending. Hopefully, this has given you a helpful introduction into Affinity Photo blending ranges. In a future video, I'll demonstrate how you might use this to simulate luminosity masking. I'm Robin Whalley, you've been watching Lenscraft, I'll see you next week for another video.